Google knows more about you than you know about yourself. It's good or bad, we'll talk about that later. But what's important is how they know everything. From a long time, Google, Facebook, and all these big companies, they are collecting your data, your personal data, your online activities, and your places you visit as well. Your mom knows you are in college, but Google knows where you are. Right? Now, how exactly is this happening? To store all this unstructured data and analyzing them, they need some technologies, right? It starts from the first one, which is big data. Now, big data world has certain tools and frameworks. Example, we have Hadoop, we have Scala. So using those tools, you can analyze them, you can store them. But what's more impacting here is the next big technology, which everyone knows, of course, which is artificial intelligence. AI is changing our lifestyle, right? Starting from the smart homes, the devices which you have in your devices which you have, Google Home, Alexa, Apple Siri, right? So we have all these devices. AI is also changing the education industry. Example, as a trainer, when I go for different corporate training, during my session, some people enjoy them. Some people find it difficult to understand some concept. Maybe there's something wrong with my session, or there's a gap in the knowledge. You can use AI there to fill that particular gap. Because sometimes you don't know what you don't know. And that's where AI can help. In fact, e-commerce recommendation. Every time you go to e-commerce website, it influences your next purchase. Maybe you want to buy a new iPhone after 1 year, but e-commerce websites will make you buy iPhone the next day. That's the power of AI. Now, to collect all this data, from where you're getting all this data? Of course, right, if you want to make AI work, you need huge amount of data sets, and you are providing it. Because we are living in this awesome information age, right? You share all your details online, doesn't matter where you are, what you're doing, all your activities. We don't care about privacy in this world, right? Right? But now, what if I say, to run all this amazing stuff online, you need data. The data is the new currency, and we are giving that data, that currency, for free. Is it? Okay. Now, to understand how exactly all this thing works, let's go back to year 1993. When World Wide Web was introduced to the public for the first time, everyone got excited, right? A lot of big companies, a lot of businesses, they're starting posting their website online. It was Web 1.0, right? If you remember those days, those golden days, so that point, it was all business were posting their website online. As a consumer, we were only seeing that. It was more of read-only mode, thanks to this amazing website like AOL, or we have Amazon at that point initially. They were so famous. But we wanted something. We wanted to share our data online. It's not just watching the content. We wanted to have our content. We wanted to give product review. We wanted to upload photos. We wanted to make videos, right? So we wanted all those content online. And that's where we wanted Web 2.0. So basically now, we are living in Web 2.0. Now, it's not just about reading content, you are creating content. And we are happy with it, right? Now think about online transactions. Think about bank transactions. It doesn't matter where are you in the world, you can transfer money from one place to other place. Yes, we have PayPal, we have payment gateways like InstaMojo. We are enjoying it. But now, we are heading towards Web 3.0 with the help of blockchain. But why? We are happy with Facebook, we are happy with Instagram, we are happy with YouTube, and we are happy with PayPal as well. But there are certain issues we have to address. In fact, some people believe that blockchain can solve all the issues in the world. Not exactly, but I want to address these three particular issues. Let's start with the first one, a small issue actually, which is a transaction cost. Now, yes, we can do all the transactions online, but think about this. Every time you send money online, you are paying a huge transaction fee. If you are doing international transactions, PayPal is charging you 3 to 4.5% of transaction fee. I know, yes, we have some payment wallets which will not charge you a transaction fee, and they also give you scratch card every time you do transaction. Right? But we have limitations, right? We have limitations of geography, we have a limitation of the number of amount you can send per day. So basically, we don't want bank in between. Now think about bank. It's my money. I'm sending that money to you, and bank says, "What 3 rupees mera." We don't want that, right? We don't want bank in between. To solve this issue, we need a digital currency. And that's why in year 2008, Satoshi Nakamoto, it can be a one person or multiple people, they created a system known as Bitcoin. So the paper was Bitcoin, a peer-to-peer electronic cash system. This was not the first time someone created the digital currency. We have one issue with when you talk about digital currency, that is the double spend problem. Example, let's say, if I have this 10 rupees with me, okay, only 10 rupees, if I give that to you, I have nothing with me, right? But the moment you move to virtual world, if I take a photo of this 10 rupees, I can send that to 10 different people. I only have 10 rupees, I'm spending 100 rupees. That's a double spend problem. Bitcoin solved that issue with the help of blockchain. So of course, the first issue can be solved with the help of blockchain. The second issue is privacy. And of course, I know no one thinks about privacy here. We don't care who is using our data. But think about the scenario here. Let's say I want to do a cloud computing course, and I'm joining a classes. So I will call an institute to register myself. Hello?
Reddy Institute?
No, sir. It's Google Institute. We just call Reddy Institute.
Okay. I want to do a course there.
Cloud services course, right?
How do you know that?
According to your mobile number, which is synced with LinkedIn. It says you are a cloud enthusiast.
Okay. Okay. I will do my transactions online with the help of credit card.
As per your credit card statement, you have payment overdue of 65,000 rupees from July 2017.
You know everything?
I'm sorry, sir. We use such information only with the intention of helping you.
Think about this. If you connect all these dots, everyone knows about you, everyone knows everything about you. Are you scared? Now think about this. If you remember Cambridge Analytica, they say they know something about you that you know you don't know about yourself. The same company who collected 87 million users, Facebook users' data last year for the campaign of Donald Trump. So they are using your data not just for commercial use, but also for government use. We don't want to give them because data is currency. Apna paisa apna. Right? So we don't want to give our currency or our data to someone else. We want to own our data. And that problem can be solved with the help of blockchain. The third issue, the trust issue. You know, some people, they received stone in the iPhone box when they ordered iPhone online. You can't trust them, right? In fact, as a content creator, when I give my content to some company, when I sell them to some company, I'm not sure if that company will resell it for their use. How can we be sure with that? If I buy a house, I want to know everything about it. Of course, apart from Vastu and other stuff, I want to know who built it, in which year, who was the second last owner of the house. Of course, you will say we have database, we can store everything on database, but database can be hacked. Database can be changed with a simple SQL query. We don't want that. We don't want a mutable database. What we need is a immutable database. So if you want to build trust in this world, we want an immutable, decentralized, because we don't want to depend upon central servers like Facebook, Apple. They can use your data. And that's where you can build trust with the help of blockchain. But what is blockchain? Now, when you talk about blockchain, the name suggests it will be chain of blocks, right? Exactly. So we have blocks there, and every block will have some transactions. So let's say 100 transactions. Now, what is transaction? So if I send you 5 bitcoins, that's one transaction. So in each transaction, you can have, let's say we have sender address, so my address, the receiver address, and the amount. Now, of course, don't think that this will be your home address or this will be your personal address. It will be your public address. Basically, we use a concept of public key cryptography here, where we have a concept of public keys, private keys. As name suggests, public key is for everyone, and private key is something which you know, which only you know, right? So we secure the system with the help of public key cryptography there. Now we use one more concept of hashing. Now what is hashing? Imagine your digital fingerprint. So the way you have to unlock your phone, we use your fingerprint, right? The same way, every block will have a fingerprint, and that we can call it as hash. The moment you change something from the block, even if you change one bit, it will change the hash. So we use a concept of cryptography, we use a concept of hashing. And then what if you have more blocks? So let's create one more block here. So we got second block as well. Now if you observe, the second block will have the hash of the first block. So you don't have data, you also have the hash there. But now question arises, if I send you 5 bitcoins, and if that transaction is stored in a block, who will have that block? Can we have that block with banks? Maybe we don't want them. Can we have that block data in my machine? I can change it. I can say I have sent you 10 bitcoins. Okay, let's have that block in your machine. You can change it. You can say you have only sent 2 bitcoins. Right? So that's, again, the trust issue. What if we can create a network of 10 nodes? Oh, what is node now? Every machine, we can name it as nodes. So we can have that block in 10 different machines. So if I change, you can verify with 9 other people. If you change, I can verify with 9 other people. So somewhere we are building trust. But what if I'm a great hacker? I can hack all the 9 machines. Possible, right? And that's where we have to build a chain. Let's build a chain now. Every time you do more transaction, you are simply adding more blocks. Adding blocks. Adding blocks. And list goes on. But who is responsible to add blocks here? The thing is, in this node structure, in this network, we have some special nodes. We call them as miners. It is their job to verify the transaction. It is their job to add the block in the blockchain. But why someone will do it for free? Will you do it for free? Of course not. So what we can do is, in every transaction or in every block, we can give them some transaction fee. So let's say out of 100 rupees, we will give them 1 rupee. That's fine with us. Or maybe we can give them 0.5 rupees. Right? But then still, it's a very low amount. So what happens in Bitcoin blockchain, every time a miner add a new block, they receive some amount of Bitcoins. So what they do is, they add. So I mean, these people, they receive Bitcoins. So miners incentivized by Bitcoins. In fact, Satoshi Nakamoto, some people believe that blockchain is a byproduct of Bitcoin. It's something like Satoshi Nakamoto and team, they were thinking, oh, we have to build some technology. We want to build Bitcoin. Oh, to build Bitcoin, we have to build blockchain. This is what some people think. I feel it's reverse. I feel Bitcoin is a byproduct of blockchain. So what they were thinking actually, hey, we want to build some technology like blockchain, but how will you incentivize the miners? Let's create Bitcoin. Right? So what we know nowadays is Bitcoin, but what is more powerful is blockchain. But we have still not talked about how it is immutable. We said it is secure because of cryptography, but we have not talked about immutability. Let's see that. The moment you have this graph again, and let's say if I change something from the second block. So in B2, I'm changing one transaction. The moment you change something from the second block, it will affect what? The hash of the second block. So let's say we got new hash there. So we got hash 1 of block 2. The moment you change the hash of block 2, it will affect block 3. You know why? Because we have the hash of block 2 in block 3. So this will give you error. This goes on. And this is how you know in some node, there was some hacker who has changed the data. But data is still changing, right? Not in all the nodes, only in one node. And the entire network can kick that node out of the network. And that's how powerful blockchain is. Now, the amazing thing is, blockchain is not centralized, right? So it's decentralized, everyone. In this decentralized network, we can store data. But thanks to Ethereum, we have a concept of smart contracts, where we can store the programming code in a block, which means you can execute the code in the decentralized network. That means you can build applications in the decentralized network. And we can call those apps as decentralized application. In short, We can call them as dApps. Now, the amazing thing is, in this centralized application, who owns it? The company who has built it. So Facebook, owned by Mark Zuckerberg. Your data, owned by Mark Zuckerberg. In the decentralized application, no one owns the application because it is not running on their server. And that's why no one owns your data. You own your data. You have a control on your own data. And that's how we can achieve privacy. So the currency, the transaction cost has gone with the help of Bitcoin. Privacy can achieve with the help of dApps. What about trust? See, if I show you data, then you can trust me. If I can say I'm the one of the best footballer of the world, of course you will not trust me here. But what if I show you data? What if I say in all the World Cup matches I was there? If I can prove that, you will trust me, right? And that's why we have this very famous quote. In God, we trust. All other bring data. So if you want to prove yourself, if you want to build trust, you have to show data. So if your data is there on blockchain, everyone will trust it. Because blockchain is immutable. Right? So blockchain is not something we want in future. Example, we have AI, we have IoT. Everything will be coming in future. But blockchain is something we want to implement now. It's the need of the century. Or not century, it's the need of the year. Everyone is waiting for 2020. I'm sure in next 1 year, most of the companies will be moving towards blockchain because of this amazing feature. Yes, we have some issues with blockchain as well, but that is something we can talk in some other talk. Thank you.